Hi, I'm Nassau County Executive Laura Curran, and I am really happy to be joined by our Director of Health Equity, Dr. Andrea Ault-Brutus. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me join in this very important conversation.
Absolutely, absolutely. So we've been talking about COVID-19 and how it's affected our county. And it's affected our county greatly. We have the number two in number of cases in the country, second only to New York City. So we have confirmed positive about 35,000 as we're speaking today on April 28th. And we've seen a disproportionate impact in communities of color, African-American communities and Latino communities. We've seen the numbers from the state and the number of African-Americans, for instance, who have died of COVID complications is much greater than the percentage of the population of African-Americans. Now, we've known that there have been health disparities here in Nassau County and here in our region for a long, long time, for decades, but we've talked about this. The COVID-19 and coronavirus has really shone a bright light on this. And I'm just wondering if you can talk to me from your perspective of what you've seen, what you think, what you're hearing, and what you've learned.
Yes, thank you once again for inviting me to be a part of this conversation. And so like you said, the COVID-19 impact on Black and Latino communities is shining a bright light on these health inequities that we've known for years. I used to be in research, and in research, these health inequities are well documented. So it's no surprise that what we're seeing that's happening in the county with COVID-19 is happening across the country, where we have a high proportion of Black and Latinos who are being devastatingly impacted by COVID-19. And the reasons are multifactorial. As you know, in Nassau County, we have higher rates of obesity, asthma, diabetes, heart disease for our Black and Latino neighbors living in the county. The health department has documented this for years. Even right before we had COVID-19, we were talking in your administration about doing an initiative to address the infant and maternal mortality that Black women were facing in the county. So we've known about these health inequities for a very long time. And the reasons for these health inequities, you know, do exist. A lot of them is because of social determinants of health. Where we work and where we live plays a role in the inequities we see. It's definitely playing a role with the COVID-19 pandemic that we're experiencing. In the county, we have lots of people who live in multi-generational housing where the transmission of COVID-19 is easier in those types of housing situations. Also, as you know, a lot of our Black and Latino neighbors are essential workers. They're working on the front lines, whether it's in the grocery store or they're operating our buses. And they don't have the luxury to stay at home. And so, as a result, they are in the line of fire. They are going to be the first ones to receive or to get COVID-19 and unfortunately pass it to the people who are living in the homes with them. And so what we have to do in the county is protect as much as possible, wear your face covering if you can. If you do experience, if you're experiencing symptoms of COVID-19, get a test. As you know, the FQHCs are allowing people to come in to get tested right now in some of the hardest hit areas in the county. So all of these things are important to help to mitigate the impact of COVID-19. Additionally to what I just said earlier, also a lot of Black and Brown people don't have a general health care provider. They mm-hmm. don't have health insurance. And once again, this is where our FQHCs are really playing a role in getting people the care that they need and the tests that they need to make sure that, you know, if they have COVID-19, they're going to get the care that they need to take care of the illness.
I'm really glad you brought up the community health clinics called FQHCs, and we've expanded, we've worked with them, we've partnered with them to expand testing. In today, I was in Elmont, went for the opening of that expanded testing site, and last week we did it in Freeport and Hempstead. Those all continue, and I want everyone to know that appointments are available. And if you have symptoms and you live in one of those communities, we're going to be opening expanded testing in Westbury later this week. Please call 516-396-7500. And these locations, these clinics are conveniently located by nice bus stops. Nice bus has waived fares during this crisis time. So if you are symptomatic, please don't overlook those symptoms. And if you think you qualify for a test, please go and make an appointment for one. Immigration status is irrelevant. I think that's really important to get out there. And insurance, if you don't have insurance, it's fine. You can still get a test. You don't have to worry about that. It's a free test. Another issue that's grown to light through this is real food insecurity, as people are laid off, not getting paychecks. So we're partnering with Island Harvest to expand food distribution, giving them the resources they need to make sure that our families are getting fed. We had a huge turnout in Hempstead last week. About 1,300 people got food for a week for their families. Yesterday in Uniondale, about 900, same thing. We're going to be doing that in about 7 or 8 more locations countywide. And people can find out about that. In those communities, they'll be reached out either through the school district or through clergy, community groups, nonprofits, so they'll know where and when they can get this much needed food. And just another thing to add, when you get a test at one of these health clinics that I've mentioned, you get a box of food to go, because we know food insecurity is a serious problem.
Great. I mean, and it's great that we're taking care of that issue as well, because many people don't have a job right now, and they're not able to afford to buy foods for their families. So it's really important that the county is doing that for families. So that's great.
You know, one more question to take us out. We're talking about how our new normal. This is an opportunity to reimagine our future. And when you think about housing inequity, health inequities, career track inequities, educational inequities, do you think that this gives us, as difficult as it is, an opportunity to do things better?
Yes, definitely. And I've been thinking about that too. And this is similar to what I was thinking about before COVID-19 hit our county and the United States. Basically, we have to partner with our community-based organizations, our faith-based organizations, and really have a really a comprehensive conversation with them as to how can we address these health inequities. Also partnering with our hospital systems, our healthcare providers, our community health centers, because it's going to take all of us working collectively together to address these health inequities. I do feel like with this, you know, with COVID-19, it's giving us an opportunity to have a new normal, to really think about what kind of ways we could tackle these health inequities, and coming up with innovative solutions. For example, telehealth is making has a big role now in our ability to speak to people they can't come into the health centers right now, and just giving them medical advice. So I do see there's a role for technology as well in this new normal and embracing that. So I definitely see an opportunity for us to make some great inroads in health inequities going forward. But of course, our first goal right now is to mitigate what's happening right now with COVID-19.
Very good. Well, thank you for your hard work. Thanks for joining me. We're reaching each other through technology as part of our new normal. And I just want to say thank you. And I look forward to seeing you in person.
Thank you. I look forward to seeing you in person as well. Hopefully really soon.
Take care.
Take care.